Hello all, welcome to the introduction to PL SQL video. In this video we'll understand the basic structure of PL SQL and PL SQL programming. So in this video we will follow these many topics given below. First of all, we'll come to know the introductory part of PL SQL, and then we'll see what is the PL SQL structure, what are anonymous block, what are name block, and what are nested block. So by the end of this video we'll come to know about all these things. So what is PL SQL? So as its name suggests, PL SQL, it's procedural language plus SQL. So it's a combination of procedural language, which is PL SQL construct, and SQL, which is structured query language. So it enable user to interact with a database server and perform some business logic out of data which is stored in the Oracle database. So it is essentially a mode by which a user communicate with the Oracle database and perform a specific task. So as the definition goes, this PL SQL is a procedural language mainly used in Oracle database for performing various business operations. So as I said earlier, this is a procedural language used in Oracle database for performing various business operations, and it works in a block. So we have to understand what is PL SQL block, because it mainly work in a block. So a block is a PL SQL programming unit which contains a set of instructions for Oracle to execute, display information to the screen, write to files, call other programs, manipulate data, and many more. So if we say that PL SQL is a programming unit which contains set of instructions for Oracle to execute, so what are those instructions? So those instruction may be of type like that any instruction may be like writing some data to files. That is one instruction. The other instruction may be call other sub programs, right? And the third instruction may be manipulating some data into the database. Okay, these are three instruction which I want Oracle to perform. So what I would do is I will simply club those instruction in a PL SQL block and execute those. So which will directly, you know, compile those instruction and give it to the Oracle database to perform those tasks. So all PL SQL program will at least contain one block, because as we understand that block is a fundamental unit of PL SQL and it cannot work without a block. So any PL SQL program should have at least one block, otherwise it will not work. Okay, so essentially what we are talking about PL SQL is a PL SQL is a mode by which user interact with the database, especially Oracle database, to perform some sequence of task in the database. Okay, so moving forward, we talked about a PL SQL block in a previous slide, so we should know what is PL SQL block. So PL SQL block contain three section primarily. First section is a declarative section, second is the execution section, and exception section is the last one. So declarative section, as its name suggests, this section are used to define or declare any variables, cursor variable, reference variable, etc. Okay, so those variables, as similar to any other programming language, we should have some variables, right? Variables to perform logic in our programming. So we have to first define those variables. So where we can define those variables is in declarative section. Okay, so it is an optional section. Optional section means if you don't require any variable to define in your programming logic, So you not need to have those this declarative section at all. You can simply skip it all together. So if there is a need to perform or define variable, then only you should use the declarative section, otherwise you can skip it all together. The second and the required block is the execution section. So this section is a required one and has all the set of instruction for Oracle to execute. So the user who is performing the task should write all the set of instruction in this execution section only to pass it to the Oracle to perform. As I said, this all instructions should be compiled without any error. So if there is any error like syntax or some unknown error, then you have to resolve those error, and then only your execution block will execute, otherwise it won't, unless all the errors are resolved. And the second is, it may or may not have an exception block. So exception block is a part of execution block. Okay, when there is an execution block, there may or may not have exception block, depend upon the user who code that block. If you foresee that your execution program might throw some kind of runtime exception, so better you handle all those error, runtime error or runtime exception in the exception block, so that your program won't bomb out when you execute it. Okay, so suppose if there is a runtime exception like device divisible by zero, right? If somehow in your logic you have made some kind of calculation, and that calculation is leading to an unwanted situation where it is throwing divisible by zero, right? So in that situation, you don't want to bomb out your program, or rather you want to handle those situation. So that situation, to handle that situation, like whenever that situation occur, what sort of action you need your program should follow. So that logic you can write in exception handling, this exception section. So whenever that situation comes during runtime, that the code which you have written in the exception block will trigger, and you will be saved. And that program, your program will not bomb out, rather it will, you know, come out gracefully, or end gracefully. So this is the main advantage of having exception block. Okay, right. So now we have understand what is declarative section, what is execution section, and what is exception section. Okay, these three sections are the core of a PLSQL programming. One must understand these section fully, where to use which section and which one is exceptional, which one is required one. So you better know all these fundamental things about PLSQL block structure. Okay, so moving on. Yes, this is PLSQL block structure. As you can see, there are three blocks, blue one highlighted by blue one, highlighted by red one, and highlighted by yellow one. The blue one is a declarative section, which always starts with declare. Okay, so whatever you write between declare and begin, that will be in declarative section. Okay, so as an example, I have declared this L underscore count number type variable, and I have also assigned that variable to zero. So in this way, I have declared my L underscore count variable. Okay, now after begin, there is execution step block starts, where I am performing some kind of logic. Like in this particular example, suppose I am getting some kind of count from dual table, and then printing that count in a to the user. Okay, so this is my logic. So I have defined, or I have written my logic in a execution section, which is highlighted by red one. And there is also an exception section, which is highlighted by yellow, where you can write your exceptional handling. So it the format of having exception block is when others, then when others means this others keep on changing, right? This is the default one, which include all type of exception, whether it is predefined or user defined. Okay, so if you explicitly want to handle your exception, so you have to write before this other clause, like when divisible by zero, then what is the logic. So you have to write the logic. So we'll come to know that part later on, but as of now you have to understand what sort of sections are there in a PLSQL block, where to use what and what purpose, as a declare, begin, exception and end. If you don't end any block, then it will give you compile error, it will not run, it will not execute your the block you have written. Okay, so it's always have end at the very end of the block, so which tells the compiler that this PLSQL block has ended, so you should compile it first. Okay, so these are the main format of a PLSQL block. And one more thing is any statement will always end by a semicolon. If you omit any semicolon from any line, then it will give you error. So as you can see, all lines I have ended with semicolon here. These are okay, so you should end all the lines with semicolon. Moving on, the name block. What is name block? As you can see, we should go to the previous slide to understand what is anonymous block. So this, where you have not given any name to this block, you just simply started with declare, begin and exception and end. So this is an anonymous block, which means this is not pre-compiled and stored in the database. Okay, this is not stored in the database, and this is not also pre-compiled, and there is no name reference to it, so which is called anonymous block. This is the perfect example of anonymous block. Now, rather to the next slide, we are talking about named block structure. Named block structures are the compiled and stored in a database, unlike anonymous block, which are not. As I already told you, that these name blocks are pre-compiled and stored in the database, and we can use those name blocks repeatedly in our logic or in our programming. Okay, like anonymous block, where we cannot reference one anonymous block from some different anonymous block or from name block. Okay, so name block can be called from other name block as well as an anonymous block. So if you go to the this slide, anonymous slide, in the execution section, I can call one name block. Okay, how to do that, how to call that particular name block or a procedure, so you'll see later on. But as of now, you should understand that anonymous block is an like as its name suggests, it's anonymous. It has not stored anywhere in a database, and neither it is pre-compiled. Okay, so to create a name block, what we have to do is just we have to add create or replace a keyword. Create or replace procedure, I have used share procedure because in this particular example I want to create a one named procedure. In place of procedure, you can also have create or replace function. In that case, it would create a named function. Okay, so create or replace procedure, and there you can give a particular a specified name and a unique name. and that's that name should be unique and should not be used by some other object, okay? And so create or replace procedure named block. This is I've given the name. For example, named block, you can give XYZ as. After as, its declarative section start, okay? And once declarative section finish, then start begin. Begin means our execution section. So there you can write some your logic to perform, what sort of logic you want to perform, and then exception, and then end. So this is a typical format of a procedure, how you write or how you create one procedure in an Oracle database. So in this fashion, you should create a PLSQL procedure. Create or replace procedure name block as declarative section start, whatever variable you want to declare, you can declare in this section, and begin, your complete logic will be there in the begin section, and in exception, all the runtime exception you should handle programmatically, so that your program won't bomb out, rather it ended gracefully. Okay, so this is our name block, and name blocks are, you can call name blocks sometimes, you can call procedure, sometime it called function, sometime it called packages, sometime it called triggers, depending upon what type of value you have used after create or replace. If you use create or replace package, then it would create a stored package. Create or replace function, it would create a function. Create or replace trigger, and it would create a trigger. So all these PLSQL objects are pre-compiled and stored in the database, which you can repeatedly use again and again in some different block, or in some different package, or in some different function. Okay. Now, what is nested block? As its name suggested, nested block are the one which has another block inside it, execution block. Okay, so you cannot nested the declarative part, you can always nested the execution part. As you can see here, is the block one. Block one is the outer block. Inside block one execution section, there is another block two. Okay, it has its own exception inside it. So block two nested inside block one. So you cannot nested declarative part, but you can always nested the execution section. Or on advanced level, you can even nested the exception section also, with the execution and its separated exception handler. Okay, so those are the advanced aspects of exception handling. We'll see when we handle exception handler, but as of now, you should remember that nested blocks are very much possible. Nested blocks are the one which are nested inside an execution block of some anonymous block or a name block. Okay, so this is the perfect example of how you can do a nested block, or how you can define a nested block in a name block. Okay, so as we have understood what are PLSQL structure, what is block, what is PLSQL structure, what are the different types, okay, declarative section, execution section, exception section, and what is named block and what is nested block. So in this tutorial, we have come to know that the entire structure of a PLSQL block. Okay, so now we'll see programmatically how does it work. Okay, we'll will create first sample hello world PLSQL program so that you come to know how it works practically. Okay. Okay. Moving now on the practical session. So whatever I have taught you in the previous slides about PLSQL block, how does it made into a block structure, and so on. So we'll practically see what is the PLSQL block look like and how does it work. So this is the very simple programming PLSQL block. So where I have just used this declare begin and end declarative section and begin section execution section, but I have not used the exception section. So I told you earlier also that is also optional one. So it's up to me. I can choose it to use it or not to choose it. Okay. So as of now, I haven't choose it in my code. Okay. What I have done is this. You just forgot this this statement. Later on, you will come to know. Just for now, you just remember that this is to see the output in the output of the entire PLSQL block here. Okay, it just enable the output for the user to view. Okay, and before everything else, this is a SQL developer. You can, there is a tool SQL developer provided by Oracle itself to interact with the database and to interact programmatically with the database in the form of PLSQL and SQL. So it's a free available in on an Oracle site. You can go and download SQL developer. This is a very good tool to actually view the data, unlike the traditional SQL plus prompt where the data is not that good to view. So here you can actually see the data very good, and the output is also very very well visible by to the user. Okay, so as of now, what I have done is I have created two variables, L number one and number type, and assign a value to two, and there's another variable two, number type. I haven't initialized this. Okay, in the execution block, I have initialized this with number two with the value of 2 plus the value of number 1, and I'm just doing the arithmetic mathematical expression, and I'm just printing the value, some string. Okay, I remember that that will be in next video. For this program, you just remember that the strings can be anything inside a single quote in PLSQL. So I have just this is the string I want to print in output in the single quote, followed by the concatenation operator. This is the double pipe. So here you can concatenate two strings in PLSQL and followed by the output. Whatever output is from this mathematical expression will get concatenate with the string. Okay, and this is the entire string I want to print. Okay, so if I clear this output and again, so some it will execute program PLSQL procedure successfully completed. The sum of two number is 4, which was expected, because 2 plus 2 is 4, and the entire message has been printed. Okay, so as of now, this is classical example of anonymous block, a simple PLSQL block without any exception block. Okay, so now we just do some modification. Okay, in case if some exception comes, okay, then we don't want to bombard this program. Rather, we want it should end it gracefully with a message. Then we will see exception when others, then you can copy here the exception occurred followed by concatenated with SQL error message. So as of now, there is no exception, so this message hasn't printed. Okay, now we just want to induce some exception condition so that our this exception block execute. Okay, so as I said, this others clause is a default clause. It includes all the exception, whether it is predefined or user defined. So any exception which encounter in execution block, the control will come here. Okay, suppose I am inducing divisible by zero exception. I am further divided it to zero. Right. See. What I did is I just include one exception block to handle all the unwanted situation which might come during execution of my execution section. Okay, here I have intentionally induced one divisor is equal to zero exception here, because I am dividing it to zero, and this is a simple mathematics that if any number is divisible, cannot be divided by zero, it gives some unwanted result. Okay, so whenever this compiler hit this line, it immediately hit that runtime exception which is called divisor is equal to zero. For this exception we have already handled in exception block. Okay, so code, whenever after this line, control will not go to the next line here, rather it skip all the execution block. It will directly come to the exception block. Okay, it will not execute the remaining execution block from the point it encountered the exception. It will directly come to the exception block here, and it will put or print this line, this message. Okay, suppose if I don't, as I've already seen that the code has ended gracefully, it has not bombarded. Okay, now if we want to bomb out our code, then we should do is we just remove this part. Okay, so it will give you the error, runtime exception error, that this is the line that compiler hit, which is saying that divisor is equal to zero. Okay, so in this case your program is bombing out, it is not gracefully ended. Okay, rather if you just bring back the exception block and run it again, so this message, although PL SQL procedure successfully completed, but it has some exception. So user what whoever is executing this block come to know that this is the exception this program hit, although it is successfully ended, but it has some runtime exception we should remove. So this was the basic, very basic PL/SQL anonymous block. Just to give you an understanding how it works with exception or without exception. Okay. So, I provide you one example where this exception block is an optional one. So declare is also an optional block, but I need this variable in my execution block. So I have to declare this variable first. That's why I had to use declare. If I had not used this variable, then it was not necessary for me to have this declare block. I rather could go with only begin and exception. Okay, this is the one point you have to remember about declarative section and exception section. Okay. Okay. Now, the second example I'll take of a name block. Suppose this is the previous anonymous block which we have used. Okay, so now we want to convert this anonymous block to a named one. So what I will do is I will write create or replace procedure test named block. This is the name which I have given as. So as I told you earlier, this is the keyword which is used to create a name block. Okay, I use create or replace test name block as number one, and after this as there's a declarative part, and then begin. And the same, all the remaining things are kept as same as those were in anonymous block. Okay. Now, if you see, if we run this, what it will do is in the output is procedure t test name block is compiled. That means this procedure, whatever procedure we have, this name block, as of now, I have used this procedure keyword here. So this is a stored procedure now. So this is a pre-compiled, as I told you earlier, this is a pre-compiled and stored in a database which can be called from some other application or some other process later on for further processing. So as of now, this procedure is now compiled and stored in the database. Okay, so but before this, let's change the string which will easily distinguish that which string is coming from a name block or an anonymous block. So I will write here named block. Here also I write named block. Here also I write name. Okay. Now I am calling this name block from first anonymous block. Okay. I can write here calling name block here. We can write name block is also sorry completed. Okay, what I have done is I have called this test name block as it is. It means I am calling this procedure. Okay, after this line, it will, the control will go to this PL SQL block, this name block, and execute here, execute these lines, and then once the execution complete, it will again go back here and will start execution at the next line of the sequence. So if it, yes, so it means since this is the exception occurred here, okay, it simply skipped all these lines and it went to exception block and print the error, which is divisor is equal to 0. Now we're gonna remove this. I can simply remove this line. Now we need to understand. Sum of two numbers is 4. Congratulations, you have performed first SQL PL SQL calculation calling name block. Now it printed up to here, then this name block called it, the control went there, and immediately at the second line the same exception occurred, it again went back to this. Okay, so this method, this message printed in the exception block of a name block. So I just again remove this exception causing line, and I again need to recompile the name block because something I have changed in the code. So just to reflect those changes, I need to recompile this block PL SQL test name block compiled. So again, okay, run this. See here, name block. These are the messages are coming from anonymous block, and these are the message coming from name block. Okay, so you must know, you have come to know that how the control works in case of exception as well as the normal situations. Okay, whenever there is an exception occurred in the code, it will not execute the next line, rather it will go directly to the exception block and do the processing there. Okay, we have seen this situation earlier. Okay, what else we can do here is, yeah, so this is the name block we have done, and there is another which is called nested block. What we can do is here in the exception block, in the same anonymous block in the previous example, we can again write one nested block, which is can give here. You can give the message here. Hey, I am in the nested block. Okay, so this block, remember I have said that both declarative and exception are the optional one. So I'm not using those two section in this PLSQL block. Okay, just for the sake of simplicity. If you want to have, then you can surely have. We'll see in some different examples. Okay, now again run it. See here. Name block is successfully completed. After this, there is a nested block where I have defined this message, hey, I am in the nested block. So that got printed. Okay, so as of now, you can do many permutation and combination as you will get to, you know, more familiar with the PLSQL structure. So these are the main thing which you need to consider while writing any PLSQL program, that you have to handle exception beautifully if you want to have your PLSQL program bug free. Okay, so these are the main things you can learn from this video.